I met Michael Hutchence for the very first time in 1989 at the Sybil townhouse. His Harley Davidson came out of the car park. I got a quick scribble off him, a quick autograph, and off he went. And I thought, that autograph wasn't too good. I don't know what it was. I don't know why I thought that was a good or a bad autograph. I'd never met him before. That might have just been his autograph. But something told me to wait. So I waited 8 hours. And I heard Michael's Harley come back down the street. And I got another autograph. And I was 16 at the time. And I didn't know what charisma was. But there was something really unique and really special about him. And just an incredible person to meet. And we just got talking. And he told me that INXS were going to go into the recording studios in the following months to record an album. Again, I heard Michael's Harley Davidson come down the street, roaring down the street. He got off the Harley. I hadn't seen him for a month or so. And he was really, really nice. He remembered me from when I last met him. He invited me up to the studios. I met the other guys from INXS. I got my Kick record signed, which was fantastic. And I had so much fun. I went back the next day and the next day. Well, I ended up spending my whole school holidays of, which was about 5 or 6 weeks. And then it came time to go back to school. And I was having a lot of fun and I wanted to become a photographer. That was what I wanted to do as a kid and a teenager. And I was a kid and a teenager. And so it came time to go back to school, which would have been year 10 for me in 1990. And I said to my mum, I've got great access to INXS. Michael Hutchence was one of the biggest rock stars and celebrities in the world at the time. And instead of going back to school, can I stay with INXS and Michael Hutchence at the studios? And my mum said yes. So I left school and I ended up spending 5 months at the recording studios hanging out with INXS. I think when you've lived with an illness your whole life, it almost becomes the norm. So you're used to being sick, you're used to being the youngest person in the waiting room to see a specialist. You know, every time I see a specialist, I'm always the youngest person in there. When I was 4 and a half, I was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. So that was probably the biggest challenge in my whole life. And as I've gotten older, I'm almost 46. It's becoming a greater challenge because my health is slowly getting worse. So when I was quite young, I distinctively remember going to see a specialist and he said, you probably won't make 21. And I remember thinking, I never wanted my life to be boring. And that might have kind of spurred me on to try to find something outside of the normal life, you might say. You know, I didn't want to just have something like everybody else. I didn't want a boring life. I didn't want to just be like any other kid. Meeting Michael Hutchence as a 16-year-old kid, you know, certainly changed my life. He was, you know, very kind and generous with me. And then meeting all the other celebrities. And then, you know, when I was first meeting celebrities, I was still at school. So I was going back to school and I'd had all these amazing stories and I'd had photos and I'd had autographs and, you know, I was meeting, you know, Nelson Mandela or Tony Hawk, you know, so, and I'd go back to school and tell the stories and, you know, instantly I became popular because there I was, this kid that, you know, on the weekends was hanging out with, you know, the who's who of the celebrity world. And then I'd go to school on a Monday and everyone was like, who'd you meet on the weekend, you know? So, you know, in that sense, I was always different, but I think it had a big impact on me being a diabetic and being told at a young age that I probably wasn't going to live, you know, past 21. So I knew I wanted to do something different, something exciting. And I ended up getting into the world of, you know, celebrity. And I certainly made my life a lot more exciting than many of the other kids at school. When we used to get our film done and film processed, you know, in the 90s before digital technology came in, I used to get my photos processed and put them in a photo album. In about 1993, 94, I was going through my photo album. And just by as a coincidence, all the photos that I'd put in these photo albums, there was three or four of them, were placed in the albums in a chronological order, just because that's how I get the films processed. So it started off in 89, 90, 91, 92, 93, 94, 95. And throughout those early years, at the beginning when I first started meeting celebrities, I hadn't gone through puberty. By, you know, 1992, 93, I had gone through puberty and my appearance had changed a lot. And I'd realized that from, you know, 89 to say 95, I'd looked, you know, a lot different. And the photos were showing that, you know, in that chronological order in the photo albums. And I thought, if I continue to get my photos taken with celebrities or people that were going to be remembered in history for another 5 or 10 or 15 more years, you know, one day that would make for a really interesting exhibition. So for 25 years, I continued on this journey, you might say, of meeting as many celebrities or as many people that I thought that were going to be remembered in history to get my photo taken with them. And in 2007, I had a book release called Richard and Famous, and that documented about 19 or 20 years of my life, meeting celebrities, taking photos of them, getting my photo taken with them. And of course, behind every photo is a story. It doesn't matter what photo it is. It could be a photo of you having breakfast, or it could be a photo of you with Nelson Mandela. But there's a story behind every single photo. And because I'd met 2,000 or 3,000 celebrities over those, you know, 20, 25 years, I had a lot of stories, and the photos told the story as well. So what I did was I had an idea, and because my name's Richard, I had an idea for this exhibition called Richard and Famous. And I pitched it to a gallery in Sydney to have an exhibition. Basically, it's a timeline of my life starting in 1989, and it goes for 25 consecutive years, and I've documented my life in those 25 years. So it's me with celebrities over 25 consecutive years. So and that's gone into galleries all around the world.
And so my mind's racing and I think, got it. So in the lift I said, oh, you're Peter O'Toole. And I said, so you wouldn't believe this, my grandfather went to school with Peter Finch in Australia. Not true. And he goes, really? I said, yes. He said, tell you what, he told me a great story about when Peter Finch knew, when Finchie and you bought a pub when you were drunk. He said, that's correct, we did do that. And we start talking about my grandfather was good friends with Peter Finch. And I said, look, my grandfather's still alive. He's 90-something now. Is there any chance of getting a photo with you so I can show him? That'd be a great thing. And he goes, of course. So in his mind, he's not posing for me, he's posing for my grandfather, who was good friends with Peter Finch. So I got the photo, we got out of the lift, we were standing there outside of his door in the hotel.
By 2013, it was 25 consecutive years that I'd met celebrities. I'd spent my life hanging at hotels or going to Los Angeles or, you know, going into parties or different events that where celebrities were going to be. It was a lot of hard work. It was thousands and thousands upon hours of doing it. In the last couple of years of it, I hated, absolutely hated. In fact, I was embarrassed to go down to a hotel. You know, I was in my late 30s and there was 16-year-old kids hanging out there for Justin Bieber, and there I was, you know, a 38-year-old man standing with 15 kids. The thing I had to think of is, did I want to spend that time down at the hotel waiting for a celebrity that I didn't care about? And in those last couple of years, I wasn't meeting celebrities for any joy, any great satisfaction. I was meeting celebrities because I wanted to get to 25 years of rich and famous. So I kept at it, I worked on it very hard. But by the end of 2013, I was completely over meeting celebrities. But I did get to the 25 years, and the Rich and Famous exhibition is the only exhibition in the world like it, where somebody had spent 25 consecutive years documenting their life in photos with celebrities. by 2012, every moment of everybody's lives have been documented in one way or another, where it's, you know, on social media or with photography, or, you know, everything's documented these days. What I was doing with Richard and Famous was I was documenting my life before many other people were doing it. So from 15 to 40, I documented my life in photographs with celebrities. You know, in my day, you had to get your film processed. That might take 2 or 3 days of dropping your film off. And as the years went on, it was 1 hour photo labs became the thing. So I had to wait 1 hour to see if my photo turned out with me, with, say, Billy Joel, for instance. So I think this generation these days, everything's been documented for them, because that's just the world we live in. In my day, life wasn't documented as heavily as what I was doing it, I guess, with myself, where I was documenting my life. Almost every year of my life, you know, was documenting my life somewhere or another in photographs. Oh, I was standing, you were there.